South Face of Annapurna is something completely beyond what anyone's tried in the Himalayas. A lot of people said, oh, it's impossible. But I wouldn't have wanted to go and just climb another mountain, even a hard mountain, which was just repeating an experience.
Chris Bonington, leader of the Annapurna expedition. For Bonington, climbing a great mountain was no longer enough. He wanted to climb Annapurna by the most difficult route, the south face.
Not a so good climber to set about this climb, you know, it's suicide, but I think different climbs, bigger climbs every year, I think, has to be a must, really. You can't just say, I've climbed the Eiger, I've climbed the Matterhorn, I've climbed Everest and finish. It just doesn't finish there.
Don Whillans, deputy leader, 36 years old, a plumber from Lancashire.
If climbing was completely safe, you know, I mean, if they found some way of stopping avalanches, or if you fell off backwards, you know, your wings sprouted out and you just flew back to your original position, then it wouldn't have the same attraction that it had before. But it's, I should imagine, for a car racer or a steeple jockey, he's taking calculated risks, which he knows that he can control. It's just the occasional time that something happens and there's an uncalculated risk, and this is the thing that generally kills people.
Mick Burke, 28 years old, another northerner, a student at a film school.
Would you think it worth the loss of life to get up this mountain? I mean...
No, I don't think any of us on this expedition would. Yeah, I think if there was a casualty at all, it would be a question of withdrawing altogether.
Ian Clough, 30, climbing instructor. His wife is also a climber. Ian Clough, reckoned the safest of mountaineers by his fellow climbers.
We all do know each other very well, and it would be more than just, you know, a soldier being shot next to you on the battlefield sort of thing.
Four of the 10 climbers attempting the south face of Annapurna. Till now, Himalayan mountaineers had looked for the easiest route to the top. Bonington and his team deliberately chose the hardest way up. The Annapurna expedition arrives at Pokhara in Nepal. This was the strongest climbing team ever to leave England. 9 Britons and 1 American, all of them experienced on dangerous mountains throughout the world. None more so than the Scot, Dougal Haston, the first man up the perilous direct route on the Eiger.
Are you professional?
No, amateur.
No amateurs could have attempted the south face of Annapurna, rising 70 miles away from the airport to a height of over 26,000 feet. In the Himalayas, there is only one way to travel, on foot. Only one way to carry, on men's backs. The expedition's porters were Gurkhas from West Nepal, an old recruiting ground of the British Army. They themselves formed a small army of 400 men. It was the first time any of these porters had been this high in the Himalayas. For them, mountains are the dwelling places of the gods, not for climbing. But for £4 a week, they were prepared to carry this high and brave the end of a Himalayan winter. At the end of the 8-day march, the porters returned to their villages. The climbers and Sherpas set up base camp and sent the first men up the mountain. For the first time, they could see Annapurna's south face plain, 2 miles high, dominating base camp at 14,000 feet. The south face was a wall of rock and ice of massive height. The world's highest building, New York's Empire State, is 1,250 feet high. It looks small enough against the north face of the Eiger, the most dangerous climb in Europe. But the Eiger is swallowed up by the south face of Annapurna. And here the climbing would be just as hard, but its greater height would make every move more difficult. From base camp, the expedition planned to pick its way through 2 ice falls up to the first great obstacle on the face, the ice ridge. Higher still, they would have to tackle at altitude the rock band, 1/2 mile of vertical rock that barred the way to the summit. Side view, the mountain looks even more formidable. No one even knew whether a mountain face so steep could be climbed at such a height. But before the great obstacles could be tackled, the first 3 camps had to be established lower down, and 5 tons of food and equipment carried up to 20,000 feet. When Camp 3 was stocked up, the real climbing would begin. In early April, the 6 expedition Sherpas began to carry loads from base camp to camps 1 and 2. There is no quick way up a Himalayan mountain. Day after day, load after load, camp after camp, the supplies have to be slowly forced up. The Sherpas live high on the slopes of Everest itself. They have worked as high-altitude porters since Himalayan expeditions started 50 years ago. Every day there was movement on the mountain. While the climbers out in front were finding the route and fixing the rope, the load carriers followed. On these lower slopes, the main dangers were from avalanches and ice falls, unstable ice blocks that at any moment might melt and fall. No one liked the journey under these ice cliffs below Camp 2. Higher up, Whillans and Haston had forged ahead to establish Camp 3 at 20,000 feet. Dougal Haston hadn't enjoyed the carry.
This, in fact, is the nasty part of Himalayan climbing. Everyone dreams of dashing glory and leading out in front and doing the beautiful pitches and enjoying the climbing and the scenery. But in fact, for a majority of the time, your head's down in the snow and you're plodding up with a big monkey on your back.
The carry to Camp 3 at 20,000 feet took its toll as the climbers struggled to acclimatize to the thin air. Mike Thompson found it hard going.
Most of the way it's up a very steep, well, up a fairly steep gully, up snow, so that it's, about 40 degrees. And you're just walking in the steps of the, if you're lucky, you're walking in the steps of the man in front. If you're unlucky, you are the man in front, making the steps. There's nowhere very much you can get a rest. You just sort of lean forward on your ice axe and sort of wheeze for 1/2 minute or so, and then plod on for a few more steps.
In spite of the views, Haston and Whillans were also suffering.
20,000 is a kind of crunch barrier where people really get knocked up on this expedition.
Living at high altitude is dirty and uncomfortable. Don Whillans.
When you wake up in the morning and the inside of the tent is all covered with thick frost, and then the sun strikes it. Well, you're waiting for the sun, but there's always a hitch somewhere. It melts all the ice, of course, and it drips all over you. And then after the first hour, when everything's nice and dry again, that's when you start to enjoy it. You can come out and walk around and have a look at all the peaks, and that's great. And then there comes the point where you got to put your sack on and start, and for the first 10 minutes, quarter of an hour, that's purgatory. Anybody bounds out of bed at 20,000 feet, and what, how marvellous it all is and how great you feel. I always think they're either putting on an act or there's something peculiar about them, because you just don't feel like that at 20,000. And of course there's all sorts of problems at that altitude. It's very difficult breathing wise, the air's a bit thin on the ground, and you usually get severe headaches, vomiting, diarrhea, all sorts of things.
Whillans and Haston, so different in character, were blending into an ambitious team, always happy to be in front.
I don't think we'd really be going up there if we were suffering all the time. It'd be a bit of a futile exercise if you were just going up to suffer. It has its strange form of enjoyment.
Above Camp 3, it was difficult to find a route free from danger.
The skill of the climbing is, of course, to avoid the danger, but occasionally there is no way to completely avoid it. You've got to take a certain risk. And I don't like it when I'm in those sections. To be absolutely perfect, you shouldn't be in a dangerous situation if you've really got your job nailed down. But I'm prepared to take a certain amount of risk. But I don't like danger at all.
Whillans and Haston had now found a route up from Camp 3, but it was exhausting. After 7 days, they decided to go down to base camp for a rest. There was half the ice ridge still to be climbed. From Camp 3, the route established by Whillans and Haston had to run along the top of the ice ridge. The ice ridge was 1,000 feet high, a series of towers whipped by the wind into a knife edge. The way was along the knife edge and over each tower. It would have been easier to climb round the sides, but dangerous. From the ice cliffs above, avalanches regularly swept down both sides of the ridge. Ian Clough and Chris Bonington took over on the ridge, and from now on, pair after pair of climbers took turns forcing up the route for 3 or 4 days until they were exhausted and replaced by a fresh pair. From here on, all climbing was on fixed ropes, using a jumar, a metal clamp that slides up the rope but locks when you pull down on it. Just getting up the ropes fixed by the previous pair was hard enough at 21,000 feet. Each day it took Bonington and Clough 3 hours from the camp where they spent the night to get to the top of yesterday's ropes. Only then could the real work begin, finding the new route and fixing the rope for it. Progress on some days was down to 100 feet. The ice ridge was proving tougher than anyone had expected. Resting down at base camp, Dougal Haston followed the climb with Whillans. The mornings here were warm, the living easy.
It's a nice feeling looking up at the mountain from here.
And
seeing someone else toiling for a change?
It's lovely, because all you see are these little white, little dark figures against the snow. And it looks as if everything's going so smoothly, and yet, you know,
struggling in hell.
Waist deep in snow and sliding off and sweating and struggling. Just sitting down here watching these little dots moving about, it's very nice. Wait to service here.
It was now the turn of Nick Escourt and Martin Boysen to take over the lead on the ice ridge.
Nick and Martin had just left camp four. See two small dots just above the site of camp four on the col, down an ice bulge. That was the way that we thought would probably be the way.
Boysen, with escort, now faced at 22,000 feet, the hardest climbing ever attempted in the Himalayas. At this altitude, a climber has already lost half his strength, and there were other difficulties. Nick Escort.
Very often on ridges, you can't see where you are going, because you can just see the next tower. You're always just climbing up one tower, and there's a bit of a ledge, and there's another one. And a lot of the time, you can just see one tower ahead. It's very difficult to get an overall idea of where you are.
Well, it's very frustrating on the ridge because, you know, as I say, you go around corners and you can't see ahead, and you think it might be easy around the corner. You get your head around the corner and there's another great mushroom waiting for you. And, you know, it could go on for miles like this, it seems, at the time. And the climbing is quite enjoyable if it wasn't so tiring.
Yeah.
And if it wasn't so frustrating that you're wanting to make as much progress as possible to push right up the mountain, but in fact you're just making 100 foot a day or so, you know, which just seems absolutely pathetic.
The ridge was yielding, however slowly, but it was now the end of April, and there was only 1 month of good weather left before the Himalayan monsoon made all climbing impossible. The route up the ice ridge was hard but safe. Boysen could watch the avalanches go by and even enjoy the view. The beauty of the mountains partly provided an answer to that old question, why do you climb?
Why I climb? I enjoy being in the mountains.
I think there's possibly, I think Dougal and I have two different reasons for climbing, you know, almost entirely. Some people could do a climb for a kind of sort of emotional experience, just a very personal thing. Mm. And I do it very much as a practical thing. I get a certain satisfaction from doing a job well, same as a tradesman would. Dougal doesn't have a trade or anything like this. He's more intellectual, books and maybe a kind of feeling they get. But to me, I approach my climb, or this climb, just the same way that a blacksmith would approach a job or anything like that. Okay, I do stop now. I admire the views and I relax in the atmosphere and everything else. I appreciate the scenery, but I know that this scenery is very dangerous. And first and foremost, my approach to the mountain is a practical one. Whereas I think the Dougal is a wee bit more romantic. I'd be perhaps taking more fuss about things where he just put the sack on and just waft off and take whatever came, whereas I would more of an engineering type.
It's wrong to say I'm romantic about climbing. That's totally wrong. I mean, I'm analytic about climbing. I'm not romantic about it. Climbing is a total life form almost. It's not just a trade. It's also there's an intellectual side of climbing. There's a practical side of climbing. It's almost a whole, as I say, a whole life form.
What about at this stage of the expedition? Is there, do you feel this sort of jockeying for position as to who will be the last the people for the summit bid?
No, from what we've seen, the mountain's beginning to show its teeth now. It's getting really quite tough. If there's any jockeying, it's for a bed in the base camp for the rest.
Do you think that mountains have got the edge over climbers, or that with all this modern equipment and modern gear, you've got the edge over the mountains nowadays?
It's surprising how easily all this equipment does mean absolutely nothing. I mean, we can only climb under certain conditions at certain hours of the day where the mountain's amenable to us, it's warm enough. But as soon as the sun goes down and the wind comes up, even a slight breeze, the temperature drops so fast and you can feel your nose or your face going frostbitten very quickly. As soon as a small breeze, like a thing like a breeze or the sun drops down, bang, you're straight back into your tent, into your sleeping bag, and you don't come out there until the sun comes out. So, really, it does have the edge. You very much have to abide by the rules of nature.
Whillans faced 4 days climbing just to get back to the front again, since there were now four camps strung out over 2.5 miles of the south face. Camp 4 at 21,000 feet was now the highest camp, and from here, Escourt and Boysen had carried the route up until the ice ridge tapered off into ice too flaky to climb. The only solution was to move off the ice ridge and across and then around the end of the ridge. After that, the way was open to move up and start gaining height again. Bonington worked hard to force the route across. The climbers called this section the Terrible Traverse. One loose peg here could lead to disaster. For 3 weeks, the climbers had seen nothing but the ice ridge in front of them. Now they could see round the corner. The traverse was crossed. The ice ridge was climbed. But its 1,000 feet had taken nearly a month. It was May the 3rd, which meant about 3 weeks climbing left, with 5,000 feet still to go. The next job was to find the site for Camp 5 and build up supplies there to tackle what could be the biggest obstacle of all on the way to the summit of Annapurna, the rock band. The Annapurna expedition had now been on the face for 6 weeks, and even the Sherpa porters were finding it wearing. On other mountains, the Sherpas had carried right up to the summit, but on the south face, they could go no higher than 21,000 feet, because the climbing ahead was too difficult. Above Camp 4, all the supplies had to be carried by the climbers. Dave Lambert, the expedition doctor, had come up to help. He had had trouble acclimatizing at high altitude, but every expedition member was now needed high up to keep the lead climbers supplied with food and equipment. Tom Frost from California did some punishing load carrying from Camp 4 across the traverse. The traverse was hard enough, but with a 35-pound load on your back, it was even more exhausting. After the traverse was crossed, there was more punishment. A long, steep snowfield, which the load carriers had to climb, the whole of it threatened by 300-foot ice cliffs. The end of the carry, Camp 5, tucked in a crack at the foot of the rock band. Camp 5 clung to the great wall of the rock band. The rock band had to be climbed in the next 2 weeks if the expedition was to get to the top. The rock reared up for half a mile to 25,000 feet, ending in snowfields that led to the still distant summit. The carry from Camp 4 to Camp 5 was proving too much for climbers who had been working on the face for 6 weeks now. Mike Thompson had to come down to base camp.
What's the matter with the leg, Mike?
I just can't get him to work. They don't seem to function very well.
Good afternoon. Yeah. What are they? Are they stiff or are you just no control?
Just completely. No. I don't think I'd make it here, actually. Where have you come down from? From four.
Oh. What have you been on, the 4 to 5 carry?
Well, I was on it for a day, yeah. Nearly died.
What is the actual carry from 4 to 5 like?
Now it's going to be split, but if you do the complete carry, it's absolute killer. Set off at 8 in the morning and not back till 5 at night.
How did it affect you?
I didn't get there. I got to the Seracs, which are about 300 feet short of Camp 5. And I thought to myself, I'm going so slowly, I'm not going to get there, I'll leave my load here. So just decided not to go any further, to turn around. I just tied a loop in the rope and hooked my rucksack onto it. And I just leant onto the rucksack to have a bit of a rest. And then I felt fantastically sick and faint. And I started sort of shivering. And then I just passed out. And Mick was coming up behind me. He got up. I felt, I've never felt suddenly so ill. And,
well, you thought you were dying, did you?
I thought, well, this is it, you know. I thought, what a stupid place. Right, now, you know, just before I went out, I thought, you know, I had a few sort of thoughts pass through, but I really genuinely thought I was on the way out, and Mick did as well. When I came round, he was just pinching my Mick's nuts out of my rucksack.
He took his rucksack off and fastened himself onto the rope, and so I caught up with him then, and He was moaning and groaning, saying, I've got to sit down and things like this. And then he passed into a state of sort of unconsciousness, more or less. The thing was, there was very little I could do. I said, are you okay? And he very obviously wasn't okay. It was really funny because I wasn't very sensible about it. There wasn't anything I could do about it. I just thought he was going to die on me. And I thought he'd just completely overdone it at altitude. And he had some nuts, which he'd offered me when I first got there.
Well, these are the one of these peanuts. Yeah.
And it wasn't a case of thinking of getting the nuts off him before he seized up. It was just that I really felt like doing something whilst I waited for him to die. And I asked him had he got his nuts, and he said it seemed to sort of bring him to a little bit. And anyway, after a bit, it was about 10 minutes, a quarter of an hour or so, and I was just sort of stood there. Smoking, waiting for him to pass on.
No, I've never felt so exhausted. You think you know, you go and put your foot somewhere, and it goes somewhere else altogether. It's just completely exhausted.
On the rock band, Burke and Frost took over the lead. At 23,000 feet, the air is thin. Anyone who had not got used to it would be unconscious in about 10 minutes. It was the first time Burke and Frost had been sent up front by their leader, Bonington. They complained that he had been favouring Haston and Whillans too much and using them only to carry. Burke soon hit problems.
On the rock band, the very last pitch which we did, there was some difficult climbing for the rock band. And I realised I'd run about 40 foot of rope out without a peat on, which meant I was going to take a longish fall if I fell off. And I got somewhere quite difficult, so I started putting pegs in, because I suddenly realised that if I fell off, I might break my leg. And up there at 23, 24,000, that's going to be hard. But even whilst I was climbing, I was working out an evacuation route. You take into consideration the fact that you might get hurt, but you're already one step ahead, in that if you do get hurt, you've got a rough idea as to what you're going to do, you know, immediately, even sort of whilst you're falling.
The environment is hostile, in that really, people shouldn't be there. I mean, the lungs aren't strong enough to be in this position. The minds aren't strong enough. But you are there, so you can't get round this fight.
Burke's partner, Tom Frost, is a Mormon. He never drinks tea or coffee. He climbs on lemonade.
I do a lot of praying. Sincerely, I do. But even when the stones have been falling up there, and they come whistling down from the summit, several thousand feet above, for some reason, I haven't had a bad feeling about it. There's a lot of suffering, obviously, in a big mountain. That's what I don't like about big mountains, is the relatively high percentage of suffering. But you have your rewards.
You'll be climbing along, and you'll think, oh, God, I'm just absolutely knackered. I can't move up another foot. And yet, if you actually stop and think about it, you're not really anywhere near knackered. You know what I mean? You've got lots of strength left. What it is you feel sorry for yourself. You've been going at this for 6 hours now. It's your brain that's tired. The brain's tiring underneath the mental strain of forcing upwards, of not knowing. I mean, you're just completely isolated from the other 500 million people in the world. There's nothing that anybody in the world can do to help you. There's absolutely nothing. You're completely in charge of your own world.
Progress was good. Burke and Frost had pushed halfway up the rock band in 5 days. The expedition was at 24,000 feet, but losing strength fast.
How are you, Nick?
Hi, Nick. Really? You look pretty tired.
Where have you come from, Ken Paul?
Yeah, from today. Yeah.
Nick Escourt's return left only Bonington at Camp 5 to carry supplies to the two men out front.
I just didn't make it to the S there. I just collapsed.
Where?
Well, at Camp 4.
Whoa. What?
It's so heavy.
Got me here.
Come on, the better crowd.
Coming down here.
You're disappointed at having to come down, Nick?
Yeah, literally, man.
Do you know it?
Oh, dear. But there's no point in me staying up there. I wouldn't have been able to. Richard, I was just burnt out.
Yeah. What did it? The carrying?
Yeah, I mean, I just done three weeks, about 21,000 is enough to burn anybody out.
Martin Boysen had borne the brunt of the carrying high up with escort. They had no hope now of trying for the summit.
How are you feeling?
Whacked.
Yeah. Somebody said something about an infection you had, have you?
Oh, well, it's just general rundown. Hands have all gone septic and everything.
Oh. What's in the...
Blisters and things.
Yeah.
They're all gone.
At the end of the fingers?
Yeah, it just makes it painful to do anything.
What about the frostbite? What about the feet?
Oh, they're painful as well.
Yeah.
Taken all together, it's by far the hardest thing I should think that I've ever been on. I should think there's ever been anyone's ever done. I should think. Can't think there's much to equal it.
Things are a bit desperate just at the moment. This weather, you know, it's just.
Is the weather bad up there now?
Oh, it's shocking. Yeah.
What sort of weather are you having? I mean, what? In the day, what's the pattern?
Well, an hour or two of sunlight in the morning, and then it clouds in, and you've got snow, spindrift, all the time, and very, very cold.
Ah. Are you a bit disappointed at having to come back at this stage when the summit looks days off now?
I tell you, I feel so low that I couldn't care less about the summit just at this moment.
Yeah. Did you think at one time, Nick, that you might have been in a summit party? I mean, were you going that well?
I was going. Well, I was always aware this might happen because I'd been up there longer than anybody else.
Yes, you've been there a long time. Yeah.
Do you wish you'd have come down for a rest, or is it just one of those things that happened? I mean,
yeah, I do. But at the same time, it's what expedition's all about, you know, as long as somebody gets to the top, that's the main thing.
Can you honestly say that, that,
but there's a bit of jealousy, yeah.
Is there? You'd like to have been there.
Yeah.
And it's just, it's that much less for you that you haven't been to the top.
It's like, you know, a game of football, you know, it's important that somebody on your side scores the goal, but it's bloody nice if it's you.
High on the face in the last week of May, Whillans and Haston were pushing up from 24,000 feet, where they'd established Camp 6, to try to find a route to the summit. They were still climbing strongly without oxygen, but the weather had turned against them. The monsoon, due in June, looked as if it had arrived early. Unless the weather cleared, no one would get to the summit. The outlook was bleak when I spoke to Bonington on the radio.
How are Don and Dougal now up there? Are they in a position to move on, or are they short of supplies because of the weather?
They are short of supplies. The trouble is that we have had to push this final summit attempt at the end of a long, hard grind when quite a number of the members of the team have inevitably had to go down for rest and are just about finished. The weather is quite indescribably bad up there. The wind gusts were very, very fierce, desperately cold. Until the weather improves, we can't make a move.
The weather stayed bad, but Whillans and Haston decided to wait no longer. They went for the summit. For 7.5 hours, they kept climbing. On the last ridge, Whillans fixed a rope to get them down quickly if they got into trouble. The temperature was 31 degrees below zero. At 2:30 p.m. on the 27th of May, Don Whillan stood at last on the summit of Annapurna. The South Face route was complete. Whillans and Haston returned to Camp 6 to break the news on the radio.
Hello, all stations in Annapurna. This is Camp 6. Have you reached me? Over.
Hello, Camp 6. This is Camp 4. How did you get on today? Over.
Well, we have some good news for you, sir. That's just after this afternoon, following the latest summit of the mountain.
The next day, Whillans and Haston would be coming down.
Welcome back.
Hi.
Hi. How are you?
How's the quality of whiskey?
Had a bad trip down from the summit today?
Yeah. It's a long way from 6.
Yeah.
It took Whillans and Haston 2 months to get to the top of Annapurna. It took only 1 day to get down. The weather was worsening. Perhaps they had made the summit just in time.
You haven't seen that one of those for 2 months, have you?
No.
Well done.
Uh-huh.
Welcome back.
Oh.
There you are.
Beautiful.
See ya.
I'll turn the right off now.
Well, you better have a rest, huh?
The days leading up to the summit, you were literally living on porridge, were you?
Well, I had 2 days on cigars and snow water. And then he came back with a few odds and ends. Slabs of toffee and stuff. And then he had some porridge. Kept having a different flavour. It brought a bit of jam. We had a jam-flavoured porridge. And then we had a mint cake-flavoured thing. And then we had a rum fudge or something-flavoured porridge.
So it was basically just porridge with variation.
Yeah, it was porridge twice a day.
Do you feel that it was a sort of last-minute effort, your bid, before the weather really closed in and stopped all climbing?
Yeah, it could have been. We had the feeling that the weather was really crawling up on us.
Yeah.
When we were sitting in Camp 6 waiting and stuff going. And it was a snatch, yeah.
Was there any moment up there when you thought you wouldn't make it, when you thought that people had just run out of steam and that there wasn't enough coming up to you to really do it?
That morning, I woke up unusual for me. I'd been thinking all night and I said a few things to Dougal, which, you know, he said, you know, this seems to be the end of the road, the crunch bit. We do it or we don't. We get our finger out. And, Dougal had been in favour of this dash, but I'd not been in favour of it. As a last resort, I was going to do it. But when I got up that morning, I thought, well, this is it. Last resort morning. Got up very early. It was fantastically cold. Very hard to avoid frostbite, you know. We're actually going very well.
No oxygen?
No.
And you didn't feel the need for oxygen?
Well, it wasn't there anyway.
Oh, you had no oxygen?
No.
There was nobody carried up from Camp 5 to you?
Nobody. Everybody was really pushed and there was just nothing coming up. So we just went for the summit and I reached the ridge. It was blowing a howling gale. I just sat there and waited for him to pop over the top and walked onto the summit, which was just only a few yards away, just a high point on a ridge of ice, and he took some film, and then he went onto the top, and I took a bit of film.
And when you were at the top, was there any elation on your part?
There was very little elation, because as I explained before about climbing, you've got to get down, and we still, because of being beaten back 2 days beforehand, in really bad weather. I think that was in the back of both of our minds. And I think the first moment of real elation was when we sat back in the tent at Camp 6.
Yeah, he was quite chuffed with himself then.
What did he say then? Or what did he do? That
he said, I feel slightly high.
2 days later, May the 30th, 5 climbers had been left on the mountain to bring down equipment. Now they were expected back at base camp. There was 1 chicken left for the victory dinner. Bonington was finishing his last expedition report. The base camp manager, Kelvin Kent, was sending the news to the outside world.
Text reads, the British Annapurna South Face Expedition reached the summit of Annapurna 1 on 27th of May. I say again, figures 27 May at 14:30 hours local time. Stop. The summit pair were Don Whillans and Dougal Haston. Stop. Roger so far, over. They left Camp 6.
Ian Clough was dead, killed by an avalanche on his way back to base camp. Mike Thompson brought the news. Later, he described what happened.
We'd just turned down the slope away from the ice cliff when it was this huge block of ice that suddenly fell. And suddenly there was a tremendous roar as it started to fall. And I suppose we only had about 2 or 3 seconds to do anything at all. We were absolutely directly in the line. We couldn't have been, it's almost as if it was deliberate, as if, you know, there was a charge there and it was just detonated at exactly the moment.
Thompson flung himself against a cliff. When it was over, he was still alive.
The scene had completely changed. There was just a huge tumbled mass of blocks of ice. Sort of the size of cars, just all piled up. And I shouted, Ian, and I went down in among the blocks of ice and shouting all the time in case there was any chance. And I got about 50, 60 feet down the slope and found Ian's body just sticking out from beneath one of these huge blocks of ice. And then more or less ran all the way back into base camp.
The summit pair were Don Whillans and Dougal Haston. Stop. Roger so far, over.
Somehow we felt we had to get the news of the tragedy down as soon as possible. And there was also just the feeling that one, you know, the need to be doing something.
A lump of ice as big as a house killed Ian Clough. Climbers had gone up and down beneath it every day for the last 2 months. They carried the body down for burial at base camp next day. Ian Clough was buried at base camp on May the 31st, the day the expedition was to leave Annapurna. The Sherpas suggested the site for the grave, at the bottom of the rock where Clough had given them climbing lessons.
Thank you.
I should just like to say a very few words about Ian. He was a fine mountaineer, and a very, very safe one. But most important of all, he was the kindest, he was the most unselfish, and I think the most universally liked person that I've ever known. I'd be grateful, Tom, if you could take care of us.
Our Father, which art in heaven, we, thy brethren, have gathered here this day by appointment for the purpose of the burial of the body of Brother Ian Clough. Father, we thank thee for this earth which thou hast created, for these beautiful mountains. We're grateful indeed for the opportunity which we have had during these past months to be here.
That Clough had died after the south face had been climbed made it even more bitter to accept.
I almost feel as if I was cheated. It's almost an unfair type of stroke of bad luck, you know, to be caught right at the end of 2 months' trip within a yard or two. A yard or two either way and it'd been all right. You can't fight that kind of thing.
1 hour after the funeral, the packing was finished. The Annapurna South Face expedition was over. It was time to go home.
If you knew at the beginning that you were going to lose somebody, the price is too high, you wouldn't go. But you go with the idea that you might be asked to pay a price. But really, you're hoping that you never will be. But, I mean, when the price is finally there, it's too much, but there's nothing you can do about it then.
If you're a climber and you go climbing, you accept this element of risk. And I think we made this climb as safe as we possibly could. I think we approached it in a sound, a sensible and a thoroughly sane kind of manner. And then you've got this element of risk, which isn't Annapurna, it's the whole risk of climbing. And this is a risk that I think if you go climbing, you've got to be prepared to accept.
For a car racer or a steeple jockey, he's taking calculated risks, which he knows that he can control. It's just the occasional time that something happens and there's an uncalculated risk, and this is the thing that generally kills people.
Mick Burke, 28 years old, another northerner, a student at a film school.
Do you think it worth the loss of life to get up this mountain? I mean...
Oh, no.
No, I don't think any of us on this expedition would. Hey, I think if there was a casualty at all, it would be a question of withdrawing altogether.
Ian Clough, 30, climbing instructor. His wife is also a climber. Ian Clough, reckoned the safest of mountaineers by his fellow climbers.
We all do know each other very well. And it'd be more than just, you know, a soldier being shot next to him.
South Face of Annapurna is something completely beyond what anyone's tried in the Himalayas. A lot of people said, oh, it's impossible. But I wouldn't have wanted to go and just climb another mountain, even a hard mountain, which was just repeating an experience.
Chris Bonington, leader of the Annapurna expedition. For Bonington, climbing a great mountain was no longer enough. He wanted to climb Annapurna by the most difficult route, the south face, to a height of over 26,000 feet. In the Himalayas, there is only one way to travel, on foot, only one way to carry, on men's backs. The expedition's porters were Gurkhas from West Nepal, an old recruiting ground of the British Army. They themselves formed a small army of 400 men. It was the first time any of these porters had been this high in the Himalayas. For them, mountains are the dwelling places of the gods, not for climbing. But for £4 a week, they were prepared to carry this high and brave the end of a Himalayan winter. At the end of the 8-day march,
I'm not a good climber, as I said about this climb, you know, it's suicide. But I think different climbs, bigger climbs every year, I think, has to be a must, really. You can't just say, I've climbed the Eiger, I've climbed the Matterhorn, I've climbed Everest and finish. It just doesn't finish there.
Don Whillans, deputy leader, 36 years old, a plumber from Lancashire.
If climbing was completely safe, you know, I mean, if they found some way of stopping avalanches, or if you fell off backwards, you know, your wings sprouted out and you just flew back to your original position, then it wouldn't have the same attraction that it had before. But it's, I should imagine,
a battlefield sort of thing.
Four of the 10 climbers attempting the south face of Annapurna. Till now, Himalayan mountaineers had looked for the easiest route to the top. Bonington and his team deliberately chose the hardest way up. The Annapurna expedition arrives at Pokhara in Nepal. This was the strongest climbing team ever to leave England. 9 Britons and 1 American, all of them experienced on dangerous mountains throughout the world. None more so than the Scot, Dougal Haston, the first man up the perilous direct route on the Eiger.
Are you professional?
No, amateur.
No amateurs could have attempted the south face of Annapurna. Rising 70 miles away from the airport,